Alrighty then. Alrighty. So now that we've gotten through the functions of gait, so we've gotten through some basic understanding going all the way back to the beginning. We talked about the difference between ambulation, walking, and gait, the functions of gait, the three tasks that are accomplished with gait. Those are important. We got through the terminology, whether it was traditional or Rancho Los Amigos. We talked about some other general terms. We've gone through that. Step length, step width, cadence, things like that. Stance, limb, swing, limb, you know what those are. We've gone through the phases of gait, the sub phases of gait, telling you about the position of the hip, ankle, and the hip, knee, and ankle in those functions. And what normal looks like. So what you're going to start to find is now that you think about normal gait, and that's kind of what we'll play a couple of, just kind of showing you normal gait, what it should look like, and then we're going to start delving into abnormal gait today. So this is just gait cycle sagittal plane. This is a video you will have. Thinking about all the things
when
that
first
are
observing gait, note the amount of time the individual spends in the stance and swing phases. Stance phase should be about 60% of the gait cycle and be bilaterally symmetrical. From the sagittal view, observe step length and stride length. Step length should be the same on both legs. Also, take note of the amount of time the individual spends on 1 foot and on 2 feet. The speed of gait will directly influence that time.
Yep. Okay, so that was sagittal plane. Now we're going to look at gait specific to the areas of the body. So we'll look at gait when we're thinking about hip.
The hip moves through a range of motion of 30 degrees of flexion to a maximum 20 degrees of extension. At initial contact, the hip is in a position of approximately 20 degrees of flexion.
So, back up. Right there. Okay, 20 degrees of flexion. And you have to think about how you would measure hip flexion. So, greater troch would be here. This is in line with the trunk of the body or with the pelvis, or in line with the pelvis angle there. And your moving arm is here. So straight down would be the zero angle. Here is 20 degrees. So can we see that? 20 degree angle. Good stuff.
As loading progresses, the hip moves into extension to achieve neutral 0 degrees at mid stance.
So here, greater troch. In line with the trunk, in line with the lateral epicondyle of the knee, vertical. So mid stance is in 0 degrees. It's vertical.
From mid stance into heel off, the hip extends to approximately 20 degrees.
Same thing. Vertical. Now the angle is going behind. So now we're in 20 degrees of extension because this is the trunk. And this is where the leg is. So the leg is going into extension. No different if you lay this person prone and the leg is being lifted independently. Make sense? So it's just closed chain hip extension.
Remaining in extension until toe off. Once the foot leaves the ground, the hip moves into flexion to achieve a maximum 20 degrees at mid swing, which is maintained through late swing.
Same thing at the knee.
During the stance and swing phases, the knee will move through a range of motion from full knee extension to approximately 60 degrees of flexion. At initial contact, the knee is in full extension. As the heel strike subphase begins, the knee flexes to about 15 degrees. During the mid-stance subphase, the knee moves from flexion into extension to achieve full extension again by heel off. As heel off progresses to toe off, the knee now flexes to approximately 30 degrees. Maximum knee flexion occurs at the end of early swing or acceleration after the toe has left the ground.
Now, here's what we were talking about earlier about coming through the swing phase. So this is the foot going through the swing phase. This is the foot in mid-swing. Look how close the foot is to the ground. The foot only clears the ground by about 1 centimeter. So if something is off in your gait cycle, your dorsiflexors are weak and they can't pull your foot up, your knee flexors are weak, your hip flexors are weak, then your toes will drag the ground and we get a deficit. So that's what we're going to deal with today, the deficits.
Acceleration after the toe has left the ground. As swing advances, the knee moves into extension again to achieve full knee extension at late swing or deceleration.
Good stuff. Then we'll look at the ankle last. Then deviations.
For normal walking, an individual needs an ankle range from approximately 25 degrees of plantar flexion to 7 degrees of dorsiflexion. The stance phase begins when the foot hits the ground. Note the position of the foot and ankle at initial contact.
So, initial contact. So when we're looking at this, that's why it's so important you look at this the right way. Because at initial contact, this looks like dorsiflexion. Agree? Right here. This foot right here looks like it's in dorsiflexion. And in your mind, you're thinking, that's freaking dorsiflexion. But you have to look at it in relationship to where the tibia is over the talus. The talus would be right about here. Vertical from the talus would come up right there. So this is closed chain plantar flexion here. And this is going to be dorsiflexion at the ankle, at the foot. So the foot is in dorsiflexion. The tibia is in plantar flexion. That's why it's in neutral. It's a 0-degree angle. They balance out. Make sense?
Neutral dorsiflexion should be observed, with the heel being the first contact with the ground. Once the heel hits the ground, the heel strike subphase begins. During this subphase, the ankle moves from dorsiflexion to plantar flexion to enable the entire foot to make contact with the ground. Observe that in the mid-stance subphase, the ankle moves from plantar flexion into dorsiflexion as the tibia advances forward to achieve mid-stance. Mid-stance is defined by the body weight being directly over the supporting limb. The mid-stance subphase ends when the ankle has reached maximum dorsiflexion. The push-off subphase begins at heel off when the heel leaves the ground and the individual progresses towards the end of the subphase. Now the ankle moves from dorsiflexion into plantar flexion to advance to toe off, at which point the ankle reaches maximum plantar flexion. Toe off is the instant that the foot leaves the ground to progress to the swing phase. During the swing phase of the gait cycle, the ankle moves from plantar flexion into dorsiflexion in preparation for the next initial contact.
Good stuff. So those are online. I definitely would encourage you to go through that. Look at those as you're going through. Mm-hmm. They are such a kind human being to do that. Alrighty, so now let's talk about deviations, because this is where I get to have my fun, because it's really cool to now identify some of the stuff that you're seeing when you're out and about, because you're going to see people with these weird gait patterns and you're going to go, ooh, I know what that is. It's going to be really cool. Just like seeing people using a crutch or a cane and seeing it used in the wrong hand or the wrong way. You go, ooh, I know what's wrong with that. I can fix it. Don't. Just keep walking the other way. Close your eyes. But you know. You've learned, so now you know. Okay, so here we go. It says abnormal or pathological gait patterns are termed gait deviations because they deviate from characteristics of non-pathological gait. So we are deviating from normal, essentially. It's called deviation because it's deviating from the norm. There are numerous causes of this, and sometimes it could be from a single cause or multiple causes. They can be temporary or permanent. There are many variations of gait deviations depending on the severity of injury or as well as the contributing factors. Okay, so we're not going to deal with all of this craziness. So let's go into muscle weakness or paralysis issues. Yeah, let's do that. Okay, so it says muscle weakness can range from slight to severe. Paralysis is a condition where there is no voluntary movement possible. So we can have a weakness that would be, things that cause muscle weakness, injury. Who's here sprained your ankle before? You're running, doing something, turned your ankle, then you go and try to lift your ankle and it doesn't move, weakness due to injury. So we all have experienced that weakness. Paralysis is literally when the nerve that's responsible for causing muscle movement or motor movement no longer communicates with the muscle. So we have severed the communication between the muscle and the nerve. Just like you cutting off somebody, I'm never gonna talk to you again, and you don't answer the phone. You sever the communication. That's what happens with the nerve. That's paralysis. So it's no more communication between the nerve and the muscle. We'll get into more details on that in the fall. It says a common compensation for muscle weakness or paralysis is to decrease the requirements for muscle strength. Often these compensations are aimed at maintaining our center of gravity over the base of support. So that's one of their goals, main goals. Still trying to walk, maintaining the center of gravity over our base of support. Okay, so the first gait deficit that we'll talk about is called the gluteus maximus gait or the gluteus maximus lurch. Gluteus maximus gait or the gluteus maximus lurch. So the gluteus maximus is really a muscle. So you're going to want to know what phase, and then you're going to want to know what it's compensating for. So gluteus maximus is really an important muscle as we are trying to go from heel strike to foot flat or initial contact as we're going really initial contact trying to get to foot flat. So the main part is the initial contact. We first get that foot on the ground. So gluteus maximus, so for that compensation, gluteus maximus gait or gluteus maximus lurch, put initial contact out beside it or highlight it. It's there in the book. That's really important. And then we'll talk about what's actually happening. So gluteus maximus gait is I either have a significant weakness to the gluteus maximus or I have a paralysis of the nerve that innervates gluteus maximus, inferior gluteal nerve. Always good to know that, inferior gluteal nerve. Okay, so I have a severe weakness or a paralysis when it comes to my gluteus maximus. So when I try to go into initial contact, instead of using the glute max to help stabilize my pelvis and hold me up, I don't have that ability, So what I do is I lurch back or hyperextend with my trunk extensors to compensate. So it's a compensation for a weak gluteus maximus with the trunk extenders or the spine extenders, erector spinae or spine extenders. Okay. So I'm trying to get my body to accept the weight, and I'm doing it through trunk extension instead of through gluteus maximus strength. So the gait is very distinct when you see it. So I will walk it so you can see it. I'll start down here and walk across. Definitely gonna wanna know what these look like. You may see some visual inspection somewhere. Okay, so if I'm walking, this will be normal gait, some way, shape, or form. Looks like normal gait. Okay, gluteus maximus lurch. So I'll use my left leg as my gluteus maximus that's weak. So when I go to put my left leg down, instead of taking the weight through my glute, I hyperextend. Gluteus maximus gait. It's funny. You're gonna see some people walk like that. When you see, you go, dadgummit. Know what that is. It's gonna change your life. So weak glute max, I'm hyperextending with my trunk extenders to compensate. Initial contact, that's when it's happening. Okay. Let's see here. I'll pull the video in just a second. Okay, the next gait pattern we'll talk about is weak gluteus med and minimus gait. Really, glute med is the strongest one. So I have a weak gluteus medius gait. Weak gluteus medius gait. This gait will primarily be seen during mid stance. So my deficit is going to be seen primarily during mid stance. Okay. Okay. So it's typically seen during mid stance. Again, the gluteus medius job is to prevent my stance side hip from going into closed chain adduction, causing my swing side pelvis to drop. So if I go into stance side adduction, is going to drop my swing side pelvis. So the problem is going to be seen on the opposite side of the body more than it is on the side where the weakness is. So again, glute med prevents me from going into stance leg closed chain adduction. Prevents me from going to closed chain add or adduction, which causes my swing side pelvis to drop. So I'm trying to prevent my swing side pelvis from dropping. Okay. So there's a couple of ways you will see this deviation if a patient can't control it. One is called the gluteus medius lurch. That's when I just let the stance side pelvis drop. So it'll be my right pelvis. When I'm walking, it would look like that. So my pelvis just drops down. Almost looks like I'm side bending, but I'm not. I'm going into closed chain abduction. So that's one of the things that you will see, like the gluteus medius lurch or Trendelenburg. Okay. So that's when I don't have the strength and I can't compensate for it. When I do have the strength, then what I will do is lateral lean and lift up the leg on the side. Looks like I'm peg walking. Because I'm trying to do abduction to lift this leg so that I can take a step. So I'm going to lean into it, almost abduct and throw the leg out so I can swing it. So I'll either have the glute med lurch where I just let the pelvis drop, or I'll have the compensated glute med gait where I'm just trying to abduct and lift the leg. Okay. Questions there. Okay. So we have Trendelenburg sign with that. That's if you have them do a single leg stance and the pelvis drops more than 5 degrees. So the pelvis is dropping down on the opposite side. Trendelenburg gait is the one where you're doing the lateral lean, just throwing the leg. The compensated gait is called Trendelenburg. And then it's called glute med lurch when you just let it drop. Just letting it drop down. Okay, so the next one we'll talk about is the quadriceps muscle weakness. Quadricep muscle weakness. The book tells us that weakness of the quad may cause decreased ability to extend the knee. So if I have a femoral nerve issue, or if I have a weak quadricep muscle issue, so I have swelling on my knee and it turns my quadricep muscles off. Now I need to compensate for what my quadricep muscles do. Okay. So usually the place where the knee is going into extension the most will be coming from initial contact to loading response, starting to put weight on the leg in loading response. So quads are the most active during loading response. Going into knee extension, loading response. Because remember, as we're going into initial contact, the knee is going from extended, from terminal swing into eccentric flexion from heel strike to now initial contact, we're pulling out of the flexion, going into extension. By the time we get to mid stance, we're in extension, but screw home is locking us in extension in mid stance, not the quad. So the quad job is really initial contact or heel strike to loading response. Really loading response is the big one because you're toe off on the other one. So if I don't have that function, what I will do is I will create the knee going into extension so that I can get to mid stance by using my arm of the same side to push my knee straight. So when I take a step, I'll be doing this. So I'm trying to force my knee back so that I can get it into extension so that I can take a step over it. Response, foot flat loading response are your big ones for your knee. Okay. That's the big one. Okay. And that's quadricep weakness gait. Okay. The next issue will be hamstring muscle weakness. Hamstring muscle weakness. Hamstring muscle weakness. What happens if I have hamstring muscle weakness? The hamstrings are active during two phases of gait. Hamstrings are active primarily during mid stance and terminal swing. Again, hamstrings are active during mid stance and terminal swing. Mid stance or terminal swing. Mid stance and terminal swing is active during both. If my hamstrings are not active, meaning that the nerve that innervates my hamstring is not working well, what are the nerves that innervate the hamstrings? See if anybody's mind is fully on today. Mine and Jesus, maybe. Nerve that innervates the hamstring, or nerves, if it's more than one. Thank you. Sciatic nerve is one. Is there another one? I'll let y'all think. All right. So hamstrings innervated by two nerves, not just one. If I have a nerve injury to my hamstrings, and I am in my stance phase, then the issue that I would have is I don't have control of genu recurvatum of my mid stance leg. So if I have weak hamstrings or nerve injury, then I don't have control and I will fall into genu recurvatum on my stance leg in mid-stance. Gingerikavatam, stance leg, mid-stance. So when that person walks, when they go into mid-stance, they fall into Gingerikavatam. So I'll show you that now. So when they go to step, they go, it's a hyperextension of the knee, forcing the pelvis to go forward. True knee hyperextension. Going beyond the zero angle with the knee. Knee hyperextension. So excessive Gingerikavatam. Stance phase. Swing phase, the hamstring's job is to slow down the tibia to allow for it to be ready for initial contact or heel strike. So its job is to pull the reins back on the speed that the tibia is moving forward during terminal swing. So trying to slow that horse down. Slow down. Pulling the reins back. So it's trying to slow down the speed of the tibia moving forward, getting ready to go into heel strike or initial contact. If the hamstring is not working in swing, it looks like I have this weird flippant kick of my foot when I'm walking. So it'll look like flippant kick. There's no control. The hamstring is not able to slow it down. Momentum is making it go forward. The hamstring is not there to slow it down. So it just looks like I'm just hyperextending my knee, just hyper kicking my knee while I'm walking. That's a good place to break there. We come back Wednesday, we'll do dorsiflexor weakness, ankle weakness, with vaulting, and then circumduction. That's a good place. Let me show you some of these and then we'll take a break. So this video should be somewhere on there as well. I certainly would encourage you to watch it. It's great videos. Mm-hmm. Gate series, is that the one? It's going to show you the name and show you real patients.
Quadriceps weakness. At the time of heel strike, the knee is normally in full extension. If there is quadriceps weakness, thus not allowing the patient to maintain knee extension, the patient may attempt to push on the thigh in order to extend and lock the knee. Adductor lurch or gluteus medius gait. During mid-stance, the abductor muscles about the hip on the weight-bearing side must contract to prevent the opposite pelvis from tilting down excessively. This increases the pressure across the hip joint to more than that of just body weight. and may result in increased pain in the presence of pathology about the hip. As Columbus was able to balance an egg on its end, theoretically, one can shift their center of gravity over the hip joint.
Now, she's weight-bearing, mid-stance. This hip is in closed chain adduction. So this hip is poking out here. This pelvis is dropped on this side. She's lurching to the side to cause for it to lift. That's why it's called a gluteus medius lurch. She's trying to lean to the side.
And balance the body weight on top of the ball of the femoral head, thus eliminating the need for muscle contraction and reducing the total force on the hip. This results in a lateral shift of the trunk greater than 1 inch and is known as an abductor lurch or gluteus medius gait. Weakness of gluteus medius muscle activity, such as in polio or an L5 nerve root lesion, may also be compensated by using the abductor lurch. In my experience, however, where pain is not involved, the patient tends to have a Trendelenburg gait.
Okay, now, gluteus medius lurch is the compensation. So that's the compensatory strategy. If they don't compensate, then they walk with what we call Trendelenburg gait. This is the non-compensated way of walking when you have a glute med weakness.
Instead of the trunk and pelvis shifting laterally over the leg in the stance phase, in the Trendelenburg gait, the patient allows the pelvis on the opposite side, that is the swing-through side, to sink excessively below the horizontal, giving rise to the so-called
drop. So you'll see the pelvis drop down right there. See how that pelvis is below the level? So that's Trendelenburg. The pelvis should stay even, like this top, this iliac crest should be even with this iliac crest, and it is not. It's about 2 inches below. So that pelvis is dropped on the opposite side. The weakness is here, but this leg is falling into closed chain adduction, and it causes this pelvis to drop. So the opposite side will drop, even though the problem is on this side.
Rise to the so-called Trendelenburg gait. Gluteus maximus gait. During mid-stance, the ipsilateral hip must be maintained in extension or the trunk would collapse forward. If there is weakness of the gluteus maximus muscle, the patient is required to thrust the trunk posteriorly, resulting in an extensor lurch or gluteus maximus gait.
Also already on Canvas. I'd encourage you to watch these. It's good stuff. Good stuff. Let's see here. I think this one is doing more neurological gait more than it is gait deviations. This guy's good. He talks about neurologic gaits. We'll get into those in the fall. These are more orthopedic gaits. Okay, take five. Come back. I'll meet you in the back. We're gonna start measuring some ankle.